Hi, let's talk about the posterior triangle of the neck. In this video, I'll provide you with an overview of the muscles and structures that are forming the boundaries of the posterior, also known as the lateral triangle of the neck, and its subtriangles. We'll also talk about the hyoidal contents of these triangles, what the actions of the muscles are, and what innervates those muscles. So, let's start with a general look at the posterior triangle. So the anterior border of this triangle is the lateral border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle, which is here. The posterior border is the anterior or lateral margin of the trapezius muscle, which is there. And the inferior border, or inferolateral, depending on how the limb is the superior margin of the clavicle. So what we have here, marking the spot, is the posterior cervical triangle. That posterior cervical triangle is divided into the occipital triangle superiorly, so there's our occipital triangle, and the subclavian or omoclavicular triangle inferiorly. But we'll take a closer look at that in a little bit. So let's talk a bit about these muscles that are forming the border. So the sternocleidomastoid muscle has a wonderful name. It gets its name from its attachment points. You know, there is the sternum, the manubrium of the sternum specifically, the medial third of the clavicle, and then the mastoid process of the temporal bone. So this sternocleidomastoid is a very thick strap that when it contracts with its counterpart on the other side is going to flex the cervical spine or flex the neck. Think of the action of drawing your chin down towards your chest. That would be flexion of the C-spine. If only one sternocleidomastoid muscle is going to contract, it's going to laterally flex the neck and rotate the face, or if you think about the movement of the chin, in the contralateral direction of the muscle, or the opposite direction of the muscle. The SCM is innervated through two sources. Its efferent innervation is cranial nerve 11, or the accessory nerve. Its afferent innervation are branches from the ventral primary rami of cervical nerves 2 and 3. It's supplied by blood from the occipital artery. The trapezius muscle, I'll outline it here, gets its name from its trapezoidal shape. So if we were to look at the posterior portion of this muscle, kind of looks like that. So this would be the superior border of it. That would be the inferior border of it. That would be the medial border and the lateral border of it. The trapezius muscle consists of upper, middle, and then lower fibers, or superior, middle, and inferior fibers. All of these fibers are originating from, well, up here would be the occipital bone, and then the spinous processes of various cervical and thoracic vertebrae. And they're also attaching to the spine of the scapula and a little bit of the clavicle as well. And so this trapezius muscle, if the scapula is, that's a poorly drawn scapula. Let's see if the scapula is going to be capable of elevating the scapula, depressing the scapula, retracting the scapula, which actually is sort of a medial adduction of it. It's also capable of superiorly rotating the glenoid cavity, so that's the shoulder tip, so as to work in concert with movement of the upper limb. So that that trapezius muscle can do a lot. If the scapula is anchored, the upper fibers of trapezius are capable of extending the cervical spine. So if you think of the action of looking upwards, you know, when your chin is elevating, that would be extension of the C-spine. Like the SCM, the trapezius muscle has dual innervation. Efferent is the accessory nerve, just like SCM. And afferent branches from the ventral primary rami of C3 and C4, carry that sensory information back. And trapezius is served with blood through the transverse cervical artery. So that's a branch of the thyrocervical trunk of the first part of the subclavian artery, which we'll discuss in another video. Breaking up the posterior triangle is the inferior belly of the omohyoid muscle. Keep in mind that omohyoid has two bellies. There's an inferior belly, which would be there, and then there's a superior belly there. There's a tendinous intersection with a little bit of a fascial sling. Omohyoid is one of the infrahyoid muscles, so it's going to be one of the muscles that are capable of depressing the hyoid bone. But this inferior belly divides this posterior triangle into the occipital triangle and the subclavian triangle, also known as the omoclavicular triangle. Let's look at some of the contents that we can see here. So we'll get some of those other labels out of the way. From our anterior neck session, we have the nerve point of the neck, which paradoxically is exiting or entering through the posterior triangle, even though it is serving the anterior neck as well as parts of the inferior head. So we can see there are various cutaneous nerves from that nerve point of the neck. So that nerve point of the neck is up in the occipital triangle. We also have the accessory nerve. So the accessory nerve, I'll just run parallel to it there. So running down underneath the SCM, accessories coming from the jugular foramen. So it's heading this way. It has quite a variable course through the triangles on its way to trapezius. One of the ways that that I like to identify the accessory nerve in this milieu of neurovasculature back here is that it very frequently has kind of a phone coil appearance to it. It looks twisty. Another content of that posterior triangle, specifically the clavicular triangle, is the external jugular vein. So let me outline that here. External jugular vein, or EJV, crosses the sternocleidomastoid. You can see here, I'll just highlight that portion that's crossing the SCM. And then it dives down deep in this clavicular triangle where it eventually joins up with the subclavian vein on its way to the brachiocephalic vein. The external jugular vein is a vein that has dual origins. So coming from behind the ear is the posterior auricular vein. And then coming down from anterior to the ear, but behind the parotid gland, that's the retromandibular vein. Retromandibular vein has two branches. There's an anterior and a posterior. And that posterior division of retromandibular joins up with posterior auricular to form EJV. That anterior division is going to join up with the facial vein to drain into the internal jugular vein. This EJV is an interesting vein in that usually one can't see it, but sometimes with issues of the heart, in particular right side heart failure, or even hypertension, pulmonary hypertension in particular, it can become quite large and distended. So one can see that EJV. Here's a view of, well, both posterior and anterior with the sternocleidomastoid muscle reflected. And the one element that I wanted to bring to your attention here is we can see some of those C2 and C3 fibers innervating SCM, but we can also see accessory nerve traveling what would be deep to SCM and on its way to trapezius. And we can definitely see it's a little coiled as it does. So look for that coiled appearance of the accessory nerve. So sometimes you may hear the accessory nerve called the spinal accessory nerve. That's the old name for it. The new and improved name is the accessory nerve. It's a little more concise and to the point. The accessory nerve actually originates, so its nuclei are in the C-spine. So you can see those from the cervical spine coming together here. And the nerve comes up through the foramen magnum of the occipital bone. So we can see that in here in the C-spine, going in through the foramen magnum, and then it comes out the jugular foramen. And when it comes out the jugular foramen, it is accompanied by cranial nerve 9, which is glossopharyngeal, cranial nerve 10, which is vagus itself, and that's where the IJV originates. So a lot is coming through those jugular foramina. And then you can see it descending down the neck under SCM and on its way to trapezius. And we can see here are some contributions from C2 and C3 and C4 to provide the afferent innervations from trapezius and sternocleidomastoid. So contributions from C2 and C3 are the afferent for SCM. Contributions from C3 and C4 are the afferent for trapezius, but the efferent, or the motor, is the accessory nerve, cranial nerve 11. So let's round this up with a question to test your retention and understanding. So a patient is suffering pulmonary hypertension and right-sided heart failure. So what's happening here is that there is increased resistance for the pulmonary arteries that are delivering blood to the lungs from the right ventricle. And as a result of that, the right side of the heart, the right ventricle, is beginning to enlarge. It's hypertrophied because the muscle has been working harder. And when muscles work harder, they enlarge or hypertrophy. And as a result of that, blood is flowing slower to and through the right side of the heart. So there's diminished capacity of blood. Which visibly distended veins may be a sign of this right-sided heart failure? A, external jugular veins. B, internal jugular veins. C, subclavian veins. Well, the truth is, all of these veins can become distended as a result of pulmonary hypertension and right-sided heart failure, but it is the external jugular veins that are going to be the most visible. Recall the relationship between the external jugular veins and the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So external jugular veins cross over the SCM in the neck, and it's this region that makes the EJV so very visible if there is any element of distension to it. Thank you for your time.